Yep, that's a clip from 2008 at the Beijing Olympics. The team leader and captain of the Kenya team at that moment, Wilfred Bungei, 800 meters, he brought home the gold. And what a better time than now to talk about that and much more, because right now we're having the Olympics. And with me here is the man himself, Wilfred Bungei, the legend. Karibu sana.
Thank you so much, Ben. Nice.
Glad to have you here.
Yeah, I'm happy to.
You know, I never expected you'd sit on my desk one day, but I'm so happy.
Well, I'm just honored for sure, because I think being in this show means a lot to me, especially coming with the Olympics that we have at the moment, because especially for us to talk about the Olympics, what it means to most Kenyans, what it means to even the individual athletes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Tell me, for you, what did that mean? That particular win right there.
Well, I think apart from the win itself is that I'm one athlete that was able to run for so many years without actually winning any medal, any major medal. Mm-hmm. And especially for the World Championships, the Olympics, the Commonwealth Games, and all the others. If you look at my history, for example, in 2004, I was the favorite to win the race. But unfortunately, I reached there with a lot of pressure. So therefore, I was not able to perform. I actually finished a disappointing fifth. And going to Beijing, I've always said this. I started there as an underdog. One of the reasons why I say that is I had run one of the poorest races in my life during that season, uh-huh. where I did
149.
It wasn't a good season for me. And I remember my coach, the first thing that he told me is that, Wilfred, please just go back home, just relax, be with family. And then from there, I start training slowly. If you are able to pick it, well and good, run the trials. And I can tell you, Levis, that for me, when I came back, I think we had a month before the trials. Uh-huh. And it took me about 2 weeks of just relaxing and going for jogging. And I realized that my body was really picking up.
Yeah.
And I was ready for the trials. I won the trials. And as soon as I won the trials, I knew very well that this Olympics is going to be mine. Mm-hmm. One, there is not a lot of pressure. Number two, you know, I mean, there's less expectations from even Kenyans, because for a very long time, there was a tendency, mm-hmm. you know, that Wilfred Bungei only belongs to the Diamond League. You know, it was called Golden League then. And many people thought that for me, he's a race guy, but not a championship guy. So I knew very well that, you know, there's less expectation. I can tell you that even the commentator that was commentating at then during the Olympics said it is anybody's race but Wilfred Bungei. And I would understand why he said that. Because if you have been able to watch this guy for over 10 years, always going to championships, being a favorite, and finishing third or fourth or fifth, you know, not even sometimes they're on the medal bracket. So it meant a lot for me. Uh-huh. And that is why I've always said that Beijing stands out for me for two reasons. Yeah. Winning the gold, and also being the overall team captain for Team Kenya.
When did you know in that race that, you know, I'm winning this? From when did it hit you, like, I'm actually winning this?
Well, I think for me, it started when I ran the rounds. Though, for me, I'm a firm believer, you know, I mean, then I remember before I went to Beijing, I was reading the book, The Secret, whereby it says, ask, believe, and receive.
Yes.
At the time that I won the trials here, I was 100% sure, I can tell you confidently, that I was 100% sure that the Olympics, I'm going to win. Mm-hmm. Of course, there would still be, you know, different committees in your head that is like, okay, I don't know what the others have done, I've not raced with them. Mm. Because most of the time, one advantage that you have, especially when you compete before the big championships, you're able to know the positions of your opponents.
Yeah.
So for me, I didn't know their positions. But I just thought then that, you know, I mean, the best thing, just do your race. So when I ran the first round, everybody actually was surprised, like, Wilfred, what's going on? Because I was able to win the hits. Mm-hmm. We went to the finals, I again won. And I remember my coach immediately told me, Wilfred, you know what? It is the finals. Just think about your race. And there are so many mistakes that I would like to inform you that I made during the time that I was running. I was always allowing people to maybe take a lead, because I was one athlete who was always a front runner. And you find that when you're a front runner and you find yourself inside the box, especially an event like 800 meters, which is very tactical, there's nothing you can do about it. It happened in Beijing, it happened in World Championships in Osaka. And therefore, during the rounds and the semifinals.
Is it because of the nature of the pace? Is it too hard to break out?
Yes, absolutely. You know, 800 meters, the problem is, if you allow somebody else to lead, most of the Kenyans, if you have watched different races, they always like a fast race. If the race is faster, the reason why is most of us Kenyans, we are not very good kickers, in exception of Aspel, Primin, Eliud, you know, those guys who have the finishing power, exactly. When you get those guys who have the finishing power, you know, whatever the race goes, if it is fast pace or slow, they can still be able to break out. But for me, I was a pace guy, you know, I had to set the pace very fast. And I realized that during the first rounds, I decided to take the lead. During the semifinals, I did the same. And I say that, you know, from the bell, from the gun, I have got to be the leader so that there is no mistake that I make. I rather lose the race, not blaming that, oh, I was in a box or all that. And that's why if you see the race itself, I was able to be in the lead and not allow anyone to come in front of me.
Yeah, there were some really tall guys behind you.
Absolutely. I mean, we had Ismail Kombich, we had Conchella, you know, who was running for Bahrain. We had Alfred Kirwa, who is a very good kicker. If you see the way if you see the way Alfred Kirwa even won the 2007 World Championships, you know, he just came from behind and was able to switch gears and be able to win. The same race that Yuri Borsafosky, a Russian guy, who was able to win the Olympics during the 2004 when I was the favorite. These guys, they are very good when it comes to kicking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me, what is the most special moment for you? You know, after the win, you know, you get to stand the flag, the national anthem is played, and it's just played for the president and you guys.
Absolutely.
You know, what's the thing for you that really makes you feel like, you know, this is a real moment for me? What's your proudest moment?
I think the proudest moment for me, apart from being team captain leader, the most important part actually, and this is something that I think I would be happy to talk about it, is the national anthem. All of us, we know what it means to have a national anthem. You can see, I mean, sometimes you are traveling on the road and then it is 6 o'clock in the morning, you know, you hear the whistle and you know that
and you stop.
Therefore, for me, I knew very well that all Kenyans, even in their own rooms, some guys who are very patriotic, they would hear the national anthem when it is being sung, and especially when an athlete has won, and they will stand in their houses. This is one moment for me that I knew that all Kenyans are standing for us. This is one part, is that I can tell you confidently that I have nothing against those athletes who choose to run for other countries.
But sometimes something
that I ask myself always is, even if a national anthem is being sung there, the question is, do you even know the national anthem? Does it have any meaning for you?
Can it give you that feeling?
It can never give you the feeling, because at the end of the day, you know, the national anthem, and especially our national anthem, is more about prayer, you know, appreciation and all the things that is in the national anthem.
Yeah.
It gives you goosebumps, if I may use that word. Mm-hmm. You know, especially when you know that you are the one that you have met the whole stadium. You can imagine Beijing, which was 120,000 seating capacity, standing there just for that national anthem. It means a lot. It's very emotional.
Wow.
I can tell you that, you know, when I crossed the line and I was going through the filtry lab, you know, I was sobbing, you know, I was really, really crying. And
it's an emotional moment.
Very emotional. I remember that I met even the assistant minister then, you know, Kabando. I met some other guys who was in the team, and they saw me, and everybody was just, you know, very emotional, very emotional.
Do you think it takes away from the Olympics right now that there's not much of a spectator?
Well, absolutely. Presence? I mean, any event, any games, you know, that is happening there, or any sports activity, you know, without fans actually in the stadium, it lowers the morale even for the athletes, because okay, you are competing against your own fellow athletes, but there is nothing much, you know, after you win the race. You know, the other,
when you're running, do you hear the sounds of people?
Absolutely, yes, because especially, you know, I mean, there are some races, the long distance, of course, the sprints you would even never hear, because it's just a quick one, it's a dash. 800 meters still an explosive race, but if you are running 1500 meters, you know, sometimes you go to those stadiums that they hit on the boards. And you hear the rhythm, you know, and it's so amazing. It's one event that you really like to be there and being in the action.
Tell me, so many athletes have been, you know, they've had moments when they have been approached by other countries. You know, can you run for us? There's more money here. Did that ever happen to you? And what would you have done about it?
Well, you know, for me, I'm one person that I was approached. Remember that the time that most of the Kenyan athletes moved to these countries, the Gulf states, yes. You know, the US, the Danish, it happens during my time.
Yes.
And I don't want to mention the country that, that approached me, and even the agents that they asked me that, Wilfred, you know, I mean, there are some very good millions of Kenyan
children. But there was some interest.
Of course, I mean, there was, because if you look at 800 meters, we had top Kenyan athlete, you know, Conjela, who moved. We had people like Shaheen. We had a number of guys, actually. And people expected that the next person that is moving is Wilfred Bungei. And I, you know, there's something that most people have never understood, that there's no reason why you would like to run for another country for you to make. Maybe you think that you make more money. But I've always said, we are very fortunate as Kenyan athletes. If you're able to run even a single race and make $1 million, some even make 10 million shillings, some make even 100 million shillings running for Kenya, then I wonder why would you choose to run for another country just for a few more
millions.
You know, it doesn't make any sense. And that is why, for me, I have always said that the best thing that you can do as an athlete, always be patriotic, always be satisfied. I can tell you that I remember when I started running, I am one person that took what we call stairs. What I mean is this. I
would run so many lifts.
Absolutely, I didn't take the lift. I remember that there were some races I would do, like 10, 20 races for only $3,000. 20 races for the whole. And I used to tell my coach that the moment that I will be able to win a Diamond League, which was paying 1.5 million then in the current exchange rate, I would close the season and go home. Why? Because, I mean, if I'm able to make 1.5 when I was only making 300,000 for 20 races.
For
20 races, and then I'll close the season.
That's a lot of work.
That's a lot of work. But I remember that, you know, when this happened, my coach, the first thing, and I can tell you, ladies, that I owe my life to my coach, you know, who is Gianni Chidini, an Italian guy, who was really able to ground me. He will always remind me that, Wilfred, these are just like chapters in your life. You know, he would always say that when you're running, every single race that you won is just like a chapter in a book. That you open, you read that book, and then you open the next one. Then he was like, if you want your life, you know, to have a lot of chapters, the best thing that you can do, forget about the winning. Because the same year that I won a Diamond League, I went ahead to win a silver medal in the World Championships, you know, I think getting around $50,000, which was a lot of money then. And every now and then, my coach will say, Wilfred, forget about the celebration. I can tell you that, unfortunately, you know, during the time that we were running,
He grounded me.
What I wanted to say is this, unfortunately, the time that we are running, it is all about competition. You go back, prepare for another competition. I would finish a race in Zurich. And the next thing that I have to is to fly back to Italy, where I used to live, go for training immediately on the second day, because there is maybe Brussels is coming, Rieti is coming, other competitions are ahead of you. Maybe the next 3-4 days you'll be going to compete there.
So it was a roller coaster.
Absolutely, it was a roller coaster of around 12-15 years of.
Yeah. Of Tell me, what pushed you into the running to begin with? How did you get in?
Well, for me, I
what are the things you said? Hey, come here, I can run.
I think number one is that I was very fortunate because I come from a family of runners, Henry Rono, you know, who broke so many world records in early 80s.
Yes.
Is my first uncle. Wilson Kukweter, who moved to Denmark, of course, is my cousin. So there was a kind of inspiration. There was kind of someone that you are able to look up to and realize that, you know what, if this person, because most of the Kenyan athletes, if you see even the kids right now, what is the best way that it can inspire them to do something? You know, it's because maybe they
looking
have seen,
at others, yes.
Exactly. They see that, oh, someone is driving. And do you know why he's driving a car? Because he's just ran. Someone has built a nice house. You know why? Because they just ran. So it becomes an inspiration. And that is why I always say that most Kenyan athletes are a product of the environment. The environment they are in. So for me, I was very fortunate because Gabrielsang location, where I come from, you know, we are surrounded by so many athletes from Kipchoge Keino, Ben Koko, Henry Rono, Wilson Kipketer, Janet Chepkoskei. All these names is in a radius of, I would say, three kilometers.
So you had a lot of people. But there's a difference between now you are inspired, and then now you find out, I can actually run.
Well, my story is
When did it teach you that, hey, you know, this thing, I'm actually good at it. You know, you can be inspired and not be good at
I get you, And most people actually ask those questions. You know, for me, when I was in primary school, I remember we went to competitions, you know, the Sonals, which it comprises of around six schools. We competed there, and then we go to divisional. And there is this teacher, two teachers actually, Sami Mandago and Fred Keter. This is primary school, Kabere Sam. Mm-hmm. We went to a competition, a zonal competition. Not that I won the race, but at least they saw that I was running very well. Mm-hmm. And they asked me, Wilfred, you know what? They called me actually, you know, mm-hmm. I was in class and somebody came and said, hey, Mwalimu Fred and Mandago is calling you in the staff room. Remember that, you know, during our time when you are being called staff room.
It's
you know,
a very serious affair.
Absolutely, it's a serious affair. And I remember the first thing is I was told, hey, can you sit down, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, sit in that chair. So for me, of course, you know, it was about kneeling first. Mm. So you entered the staff room, the first thing,
you have to,
Lazima, you know, you must kneel down.
Yes.
So then they are like, no, Wilfred, just sit in that chair. Then they say, you know what? We watch you run, and I think you have a chance. I can tell you, you know, there are some small words that sometimes they plant a seed to use. Individuals will tell you, you know what, Lewis, I think you are good in something. Mm. If you are that keen person, you will go and think about it and say, why me? I'm not the very best here. Mm. We had guys who were better in the school. But then every now and then I ask myself why. Of course, again, you know, during the primary, I was able to go to the district level only. But what I was told in that staff room stuck with me even when I moved to high school and I had left these teachers in primary school.
Yeah.
And therefore, it inspired me all the way to Form 4 when I was able to manage to represent this country as a junior. So for me, I have always told people that I am a product of a school teacher. Mm. It is apart from coming from the family. Yes, exactly. Yeah. Apart from, you know, coming from a family of runners and all that, I don't think that it could have inspired me to the level that I was able to reach compared to what those teachers. In fact, like for them, I owe them my life.
Yeah. Before I talk even about some of the laws, tell me something. Have you ever felt in the time that you ran athletics that, you know, ever had a string of bad losses until you're like, maybe this is not for me? Did you ever feel like quitting at any point?
Yes, I think especially even in 2008, when I ran 149, you can imagine that I ran as a junior 146, 147, and never ran anything like 147 after that when I graduated. Remember, this is from 1998. Mm-hmm. Until 2008 is when I was running 149.
Same year that you won the gold.
Same year that I won the gold. And I can tell you that I finished the race, just removed the spikes. I don't remember if I took those spikes with me because I really felt disappointed. I felt that maybe it is my time to retire.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the reasons why I announced my retirement immediately after 2008, when my agent, for example, says, Wilfred, you know what? This is the time to make money. You know, I've already negotiated a very good contract for you with the company that I was working with. Why are you announcing retirement? You know, every race that you go will have a better
appearance fee.
And you're announcing retirement, I say, hey, I'm done. You know what I mean? Money is not inspiring me to continue. So, but in 08, I can tell you at around June, July, I was almost quitting athletics completely.
Wow, that's just two or 3 months before Olympics.
Yeah, exactly.
And you, wow.
Yeah.
So tell me about the laws. You know, you have spoken about this in different fora, about mm-hmm. your struggle with addiction
mm-hmm.
and how you got out,
mm-hmm.
which is a really key thing.
Mm-hmm.
When did you realize that this is becoming a problem for yourself? You know, many sometimes people have realized around us, but for you, when did you realize yourself like, hey?
Well, you know. I can tell you that, you know, for me, I think even the fact that I came out and announced that I had a drinking problem,
mm-hmm.
most people thought that I was crazy. Most people thought that, you know, Wilfred, why are you tarnishing your name? I said, look, it has nothing to do with about tarnishing a name. It is about announcing a problem.
Mm-hmm.
It is about owning up the problem that mm-hmm. you have and announcing to the world that I am clean. And I remain, you know, whenever I tell people that I'm an alcoholic, you know, they think that I still continue drinking.
Yes.
They don't understand the terms that is
they don't
what it means, you know, being an alcoholic. It's like being told you are a diabetic.
Mm-hmm.
So when you are diabetic, when you have diabetes, you're not supposed to use any sugar.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And it remains in your knowledge that I am diabetic. So for me, when I came out, most guys, they thought that, you know, Wilfred, you should have not announced. And for sure, let me tell you, ladies, that there are so many people who are struggling. But they are hiding in the cocoon that I do not want to do. I don't want this thing to be known.
Mm.
I can tell you that anything that you may do later on, will definitely announce itself. For me, it took me a year and a half. Actually, many people also think that maybe this problem with Wilfred was a continuation at the time that he was running. Absolutely not. I was the most disciplined athlete.
And you never have made the times?
Completely. I mean, I live in Italy where, you know, wines flows like water, you know, every meal is full of bottles. I never touched those alcohol for me. But when I finish athletics, I can tell you the challenge that happens, and it is happening to most sportsmen and women, artists, or even those guys who come through retirement after working for so many years. You find that your life becomes empty. For me, I was a 365-day athlete. It means discipline for 365 days in a year. When I retired, I had few engagements, you know.
So you went from very active to just completely a bit of a lull.
Almost zero. Yeah. Because, yes, I would still have motivational speaking to in and out of the country, but it was not enough. So I decided that maybe I can have a drink or two. Before I knew it, so many problems had happened. And therefore, I chose in 2012, September 20th, which is one day I don't even celebrate my birthday. But the day that I discovered who I was and the day that I stopped drinking, always I celebrate.
September 2012.
September 20th, 2012.
Wow, that is now going to 9 years.
9 years, yeah. September this year, 20th, you know, I'll be 9 years sober clean.
Wow. Yeah. Let's take a quick break on that note. And when we come back, I want to talk about some of the inspirations you've had from athletes who have had some challenges. We're talking to Wilfred Bungei, the legend of the 800 meters. We will be right back after this message. Don't go away.